Okay, I will start now. I hope you can all hear me very well. Dear grantees and dear partners, welcome to the first webinar of Euro-Asian Cooperation for Excellence and Advancement Project. My name is Mojca Maher-Pirt, and I'm the coordinator of this Erasmus Mundus Partnership Project, which is funded with support from the European Commission. The coordinating institution is the University of Ljubljana in Slovenia. The purpose of today's webinar is to make you aware of cultural diversity. Ms. Natalia Spartakova, who is an intercultural trainer and project manager of Erasmus Mundus Association, has prepared a very interesting seminar. But before we start, I will shortly summarize the purpose of our project. The main objective of Euro-Asian Cooperation for Excellence and Advancement is to raise mutual enrichment and better understanding between the European Union and Central Asia through the mobility of persons, knowledge and skills at higher education level. Firstly, due to this project, grantees as you from Central Asia will be able to study, research, teach or work in European Union. Secondly, universities will get to know each other and will be able to establish a long-lasting and fruitful network for research and education cooperation. New bilateral agreements and cooperation, joint research, joint programs and actions will become possible. Last but not least, this project will enable increasing awareness and importance of cultural and linguistic diversity, their heritage and impressiveness. The project offers 5 types of mobility. Bachelor, Master, PhD, Postdoctorate and mobility of academic and administrative staff. The mobility is possible in various fields of study, as you can see in this slide. In European Union, we are 8 partner universities from 8 countries. Just recently, we received wonderful news that the resubmission of Erasmus Mundus project Euro-Asian Cooperation for Excellence and Advancement has been approved. More places will be available to grantees. Mobility will be also possible for grantees from European Union to study, research, teach or work in Central Asia. As well, 2 new partners joined the consortium. In Central Asia, there are 11 partner universities from 5 countries. Detailed information is always available on the official website of the project. We are sure that this project will open new horizons and ways of cooperation. As well, it will enrich each one involved with the knowledge and experience of cultural diversity. Dear Ms. Natalia, please inspire us with the knowledge how to understand and sense our own culture and in comparison to others. Thank you. Natalia, where are you?
thank you very much for the introduction to the project. We will now have Mojca switched off, so she's not going to be presenting anymore, if that's okay. So thank you very much. Okay, and what we are going to... be talking about will be different aspects of intercultural communication, and maybe before we start, I will very briefly tell you what is the plan for today. We will be talking a little bit about what is culture and what is intercultural competence and why are cultures different and what makes us different in all the regions of the world. And then we will be talking a little bit about your stay abroad, the grantees from Central Asian countries in particularly coming to Europe, and what might be the challenges. And I have prepared a little informative quiz just to see how well you already are informed about Europe before you move over for your studies. Maybe in the beginning also a little bit about myself and why I am the one talking to you and why you should think that my opinion is valid. My name is Natalia, and I am from St. Petersburg, Russia. Those who have been to St. Petersburg could give me a smiley. Maybe there are some people among you. No smileys so far. Yay! Very good. I hope you enjoyed my city when you were there. I very early discovered passion and interest for international relations when, while still being in a Russian school, I got a scholarship from the United States Department of State to go to America for 1 year. So I was 15 years old and I went to Texas. Now, if anyone even has not been to St. Petersburg but can imagine that moving from a large cultural city of 5 million people in Russia to a small village in Texas where there's a lot of cowboys and less ballet was a big culture shock. So this culture shock that I experienced while being in school has raised my interest for international relations and intercultural topics. Why were Americans so different from Russians? Why did they behave differently? And what was important in order to make friends over there? So after I came back, I decided to study international relations, which I did in St. Petersburg. Then to find out a little bit more about Americans, I went for one more year to the United States. And then after I was done in St. Petersburg, I decided to enlarge my focus and also get to know something about Europe. So that's when I found the program Erasmus Mundus, which you all already also know. And I received a scholarship for a master program for Erasmus Mundus Action 1. And I studied for a year and a half in the Netherlands and in Germany. My program was called Masters in Euroculture. So I was continuing to study international relations, but with focus on culture. So no wonder that after I was done with my master's degree, I found a job as an intercultural consultant, because that was exactly what I was interested in, at a company called IC Unit, located in Germany. So what I do is I do intercultural trainings for a whole variety of clients, a lot of business people going abroad and doing global business. Yes, the webinar is recorded and will be available for you after the session. I'm doing this wonderful multitasking exercise of talking to you, reading off the slide and reading your chat. I hope it works. There will be a recording available. And another part of my job is also administration of Erasmus Mundus Association, which was created for students and graduates of Action 1, of students who received a master's degree in Europe. Now I actually would like maybe to get a bit of a picture of your story. We have a lot of people, so I can't really talk to each of you, but maybe you can tell me from the very basic where you're from. And we are doing it using a special feature that we have during this webinar called a little poll. So what you see now on the screen is you should be answering. I see everybody's answering. Okay. Okay, so most of our participants today are of logically from Central Asia. Ahmad, didn't work for you. Strange. Worked for everyone else. I never know how to fix those problems when it's just a single case. Okay, well, at least you get a feeling of where the people are coming from. Now I would like, of course, to know where you will be going. And all right, I see a lot of people answering already. Okay, Slovenia is very popular, France is very popular, Germany is very popular. The Netherlands? No, nobody's going to the Netherlands, so you couldn't choose this. It's option under the letter E. Okay, so we see that there is, of course, a big diversity among yourselves coming from different countries, also going to different countries in Europe. Maybe at this point it's also important to say that during our webinar we will not be able to answer all the questions about each particular country. A lot of it would be exciting for you yourself to discover. Maybe a last question, just to get a feeling a little bit about this group, is what's the level of your mobility? On which program will you be going? Okay, so again, there is a lot of variety, na, among this group of our webinar, and this is of course also the interesting part of the Erasmus Mundus project, that there is the diversity in nationalities, diversity in your destinations, and also diversity of your level of mobility, whether it's bachelor or university staff exchange. So of course this also influences the level of intercultural communication you will be experiencing, because you will be also dealing with different people. Thank you very much for answering. Sorry if it didn't work for everyone, but I hope that for most of you it worked fine. When Moitze and I were discussing the topics for this webinar, why is it that we decided to concentrate very much on intercultural issues? If you look at the slide, you see some statistics. Of course, when people work together in multicultural teams, and this is exactly what's going to happen when you go and study, you're going to be part of a working group or a study group or a course or a class. Well, even though, for example, in this technical software, it might not be working perfectly for everyone, when in real life we're talking, it's the working styles, no? The way you do your work, the way you approach your studies, that matter the most for the success of joint projects. So the main challenge in multicultural teams is working styles. Now, I have a question. We were saying intercultural diversity, intercultural communication. What is culture? Just give me keywords. First association that comes to your mind. One word that you associate culture with. What is culture? People. Views. History, traditions, way of living and mentality, traditions and habits of people, values, language, very good, of course. Culture is very much expressed through language. More? Give me more. Yes, of course, culture is big, so it is a combination of different aspects. What about, yes, nature, environment? What about cultural things like, what do you think of culture when you go to theater or hear music? Is it also culture? Art, exactly. Architecture, literature. No? This is all culture, and it's very hard to define it. Religion, very good that you mentioned it, Elmira. So basically, culture is a whole huge combination of different things or different aspects. What is exciting about culture is that very often we do not realize it, because it's like water for fish, no? This is a famous metaphor. The fish only realizes that it doesn't, that it needs water when it jumps out of it, no? This is the same thing happening when we change cultures. Very often we do not notice how much we are actually influenced by our own culture, because this is what was taught to us in our family, in kindergartens, in schools, just on the television, you know, what is good, what is bad, what is good manners, what's not. So when we change cultures, basically like this fish on the picture jumping from one aquarium to another, we face ourselves in a totally different aquarium, totally different water, and that's when we start noticing how our water, our culture actually was. Out of all the things that you mentioned that belong to culture, we can make a very interesting observation. There are some things that you mentioned, like art or language or architecture and literature, that definitely belong to culture. And we can see those things, or when we talk about food, no? We can taste those things or hear the music that is part of culture. At the same time, you also mentioned some things that we can't really touch or hear or taste. You know, how do you taste values? How do you touch way of life, no? How do you feel the mentality? Those are things that are more abstract, no? And when we talk about culture, it's very often that culture is compared to an iceberg. Now, what is a typical very interesting thing about iceberg that was fatal or tragic for Titanic? The biggest part of the iceberg is underwater. Which means that this is exactly like our culture. There are things that we see there above water. We can see them from the distance even. But the things that support the top part of the iceberg, concepts and symbols and language and norms and values, things that we don't see, they actually constitute the biggest part of the iceberg and support the rest of the structure. So that's why it's actually difficult very often to understand another person's culture, because there are just things that are on the bottom of the iceberg under the water that we do not see. So the point of our webinar and the aim is maybe to try to look a little bit underwater for some cultures that you will be dealing with, and try to maybe understand just a little bit how we can find out more about the part under the iceberg. When we talk about culture, it's also important to mention that the culture is already a big mix, and it's something that is not constant, that is not the same everywhere. There are subcultures. Now, ethnic differences would be definitely a subculture. There are different nationalities living in your countries, coexisting within one country, that might have different subcultures. Religious differences, obviously, subcultures. Now, regional differences. If you go, for example, in Europe, you will notice how much regional differences there are when you are even within one country. Spain, very different regions, even different languages in the north or in the south. Germans from the north sometimes don't even understand very well people speaking from the south. Italy, very different subcultures, people from coming from Naples or people coming from Milan. So of course, when we talk about Italian culture or culture of Kazakhstan, it's something that we, it's a compromise. It's something that we agree upon, although it's not, of course, always correct. What is also very important, especially for countries of Central Asia region, is differences in generations. It's an important subculture for those countries that have undergone major political changes. Now, of course, the generation that grew up in the Soviet Union would be different from the modern generation that never even knew what exactly communism was, right? There would be also subcultures in fields of study, because engineers generally behave a little bit differently than, let's say, psychologists, right? So this is, again, that makes it even more difficult to speak about cultures, but at the same time, it makes it very exciting. When we talk about culture, very often, especially in the beginning when we maybe don't know much, we sometimes rely on stereotypes. Now, I've prepared some videos for you, and I hope this would work. So let's see if we can recognize some stereotypes here. Okay, just a second. Running on German television, so in the end it said French, the safest cars come from France. Now, we saw how in this advertisement there were some stereotypes used. Did you recognize the countries that the stereotypes were used for, or the symbols that were used for? Germany. Mm-hmm. What was the symbol for Germany? Sausage, yes. This is a very popular stereotype, no? A German guy always eating a sausage three times a day, yes. I also saw that Japan was recognized as a symbol. What was the symbol for Japan? Sushi, of course, yes. Now, this is another stereotype about food that we see a lot. There was something that a lot of participants in my trainings sometimes have difficulties in recognizing. There was one more country that was placed for which there was a food symbol. What was the country? And which country is it from, Anne? Yes. Sweden, exactly. This is a typical bread, dry bread that Swedish eat. Now let's think why this advertisement was why they were using the symbols for those countries. Now, Germany, biggest producer of cars. Japan, Toyota, of course, biggest producer of cars. Sweden, now, where does Volvo come from? So it was on a symbolic level, pointing to the biggest competitors of French cars. And French cars were shown with a symbol of what? What was the food symbol for France? Baguette, not this long white bread that is sold in every French bakery. So, in this advertisement, we saw how, without even calling the countries, now we could already recognize them by the symbols or some stereotypes that we're using. Let's watch one more video and see if stereotypes are used also in another way.
Zwei. That's good. Funky, yeah?
Yeah.
Funky, 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 funky.
Yeah.
Cool.
Eins, zwei, drei, yeah.
Push, push,
funky,
funky.
Feel it, push. Think James Brown, yeah?
I personally like this video very much. So, what was again the stereotype that the Germans themselves, no, were playing with? Because this is an advertisement for Volkswagen, for a German company. Yes, this is exactly the stereotypes that you're mentioning right now. The Germans are reserved or very serious, no? Interesting was the message of the advertisement in the very end. What did it say? Germans are stiff, no? But who wants a shaky car? So they were playing with their own stereotype about their own people, and putting it in a positive way. So, my question is for you. Just a second. It's a very simple question. I see you already started answering. Okay. The majority of you said stereotypes are sometimes good, sometimes bad, right? And some of you also thought, well, they're actually bad. There are indeed situations where stereotypes could be good. What are those situations? Well, as we saw from those videos, no? Stereotypes do not come out of nowhere. No? There is some truth in the stereotype because otherwise it would not even exist. No? French do eat baguettes and Germans might B, not the best dancers, especially in comparison to Brazilians, for example, right? So there is some truth in these stereotypes, otherwise they wouldn't exist. So in that case, stereotypes could be a little bit like a little compass for us, just giving us a slight idea about some cultural specifics. But of course, in what situations would stereotypes be bad? If we just decide that everyone is like that stereotype in that country. Nah? And this is the mistake or the negative tendency that a lot of people unfortunately are following, that they just make stereotypical judgments, no? That they kind of think that everybody is the same despite the subcultures or the regional differences or what's also very important, personality. When we talk about intercultural communication, and when you will be also experiencing whatever things during your exchange, during your free time or in class, there are three factors that influence interaction, that influence what happens between people. Culture being one of those factors. You see in the very bottom, this is our iceberg, no? Because as I said in the very beginning, it's very difficult to ignore our own culture. It's basically impossible because this is what we grew up in and this is what we learned. However, there are two other factors that also influence whenever we talk or interact with people. The first one is situation. If you think about it, you of course speak differently to your friends as you speak to your boss at work, or to the principal of university, or to the dean of your school. You speak differently to people who you know and people who you don't know. You speak differently to people of your age or to elderly people. No? So the situation, the context, who is around you and in which situation we are actually in, influence our behavior, of course, no? And another thing is certainly personality. Now, the stereotype is that all Italians, no, are a little bit emotional, maybe a little bit loud. However, I guarantee you that among the Italians, there are also enough people who are actually not talking with their hands and are maybe a little bit more shy and not as expressive. Because this is just the psychology, you know, we all have different personalities. So this is why it's also important to keep it in the back of your mind that there are some things that can be explained by culture. However, this is so complicated because it's also influenced by context, by situation, and personality. Not all Germans are punctual, absolutely. This is the stereotype. However, the last five times I took a German train, it was late. No? So again, the situation was influencing and maybe changing the stereotype. So this is why I'm just telling you that we will be talking about culture, but of course we cannot explain everything by culture or with culture. A little bit more theory. This slide looks maybe a bit complicated, but I will give you a personal example related to it. When we meet people from other cultures, very often, because we don't know what's underwater, we just look at them, at their behavior or what they say. Now we perceive them very quickly, within maybe half of a second, in our mind we interpret their behavior or their words. Based on our interpretation, we evaluate, is it good or bad, or do I need to take action? No, very, very quickly we have this feeling, well, do I like this person? Do I want to work or be in the same study group with this person or not? Especially if this person is someone who we meet for the first time. Now, in intercultural context, because of we all have different icebergs. Very often, as you see here, it's very often a misperception that we did not understand what actually this person was trying to tell us, or we did not interpret his or her behavior correctly. We misinterpreted it, which very quickly leads to maybe a bit of negative feelings or misunderstandings. Now, I'll give you a very personal example of myself. I told you that I was studying in the Netherlands for my Erasmus Mundus. So this was my personal circle in the second week of my studies. As maybe some of you have heard, in the Netherlands, most of people move around using bicycles. So my bicycle broke. So all I needed was air, to pump the air into the wheel, into the tire. So I, of course, asked a guy, my neighbor, saying, well, my tire is flat, I need help. Well, what he did was he gave me a pump and said, here. And I looked at him, and my perception was, Dutch men do not help women, are not polite, they're not gentlemen. My very quick evaluation was they have no manners. And within a second I thought, I'm not interested in Dutch men, I never want to go out with one because this is wrong behavior for me. This goes very, very quickly in your head that without really maybe thinking twice, you might tend to not misinterpret or misevaluate behavior of other people. What we will be looking at during our webinar a little bit later is maybe, well, what is behind? Why did he behave like that? Why he was not jumping up and pumping my bicycle, and what was he expecting from me? Based on his own iceberg, no? So the very first conclusion we can already make is that it's very typical for a human to judge very, very quickly, because we sit on our iceberg and it's very difficult to try to maybe make a 1 second break and think, well, why is that person saying or doing this and that? It's often very difficult to do that because, well, sometimes we just don't have the information or the knowledge about his or her iceberg. And this is what you will be discovering during your studies. Now, the more you know about the country or the culture, about its top part of the iceberg and bottom part of the iceberg, the easier it would be to avoid those miss circles, not to avoid those judging. When we talk about intercultural communication, we were mentioning the differences between cultures and countries. When you come to Europe, or maybe during your travel already before, you notice that the differences are there. Now, people do behave differently. Now, in order for us to make some conclusions from this webinar and for you to learn the correct terms that we use in intercultural communication, let's watch a little video where those differences will be named with the terms that we will be using then during the rest of our webinar. Okay.
When you speak, do people from other cultures understand you in the way you intended? And what happens with different cultures in the workplace? How rigid or flexible is there?
Essential to learn how to navigate across different cultural landscapes. You need a good set of tools to do this. You need an understanding of how different cultures trade and do business. An insight into how different cultures communicate. And a clear idea of how different cultures manage people. To be a savvy global traveler, you need to be willing to undertake the journey of understanding other cultures. Develop cultural intelligence so you can communicate confidently across cultures. Develop
where you already saw what are the differences. Now, what dimensions, and this is the term we use in intercultural communication, what are the cultural dimensions? Where the differences actually lie? So, when we will be talking about intercultural communication and intercultural differences, I would like you also to know the correct terms for those differences. So, the cultural dimensions that we would be talking about are power distance. Basically, it is related to hierarchy. Na? How is the attitude to hierarchy in a particular culture? Is it rather flat? What is the power distance between, let's say, an employee and the boss? Na? Can a student ask a question anytime during the lecture? Or is the power distance between student and professor a little bit higher, so that you cannot interrupt the professor and all the questions need to be asked only in the very end? Can you ask a negative question? Can you disagree with the professor, now with someone who is higher than you on that power scale? So this is the cultural dimension where we observe huge differences among the countries. Another one, is a little bit more complicated, maybe. It's called task or relationship orientation. Basically, there are a lot of cultures for whom the relationship with people is the most important thing, and it is a priority in comparison with getting the things done. We will be looking at some examples. But you can also see it all often in for example team exercises or some study groups. No, is it important for all members of the study group to get to know each other first, maybe to go out for a beer first and then discuss the project or the presentation? Or do they do the presentation and when they're done, they go get a beer? No? It's where do you start? Where's the focus? So this is the second cultural dimension. Perception of time is definitely a very important one. We mentioned something about punctuality. Of course, punctuality also is part of that perception of time. Or also perception of time is very linked to multitasking or planning. Not do I really need to have a rigid structure and get things done step by step, or am I more a parallel person? No? How is my perception of time? And of course, communication approach. Besides using different languages that are, of course, now I'm being not multitasking, I cannot type and talk at the same time. Language is of course part of the communication already, but communication is much, much broader, no? How do we convey our messages? Do we speak what we think? Are we talking very directly? No? Or do we maybe try to kind of wrap our message in a nice way, being more indirect? No? So those are the dimensions that we would be looking at in a little bit more detail. Hierarchy. I would like to know what you think where your own country is located on the scale of hierarchy. So what I will do now is I will turn on the whiteboard where we were practicing some drawing before, and I will go to a next slide. So let's say if we have a scale of where we want to place hierarchy, no? And so we say hierarchy. And I would say that maybe here would be more hierarchy, no? And on this side will be less hierarchy, which means the power distance, no? The examples that I was giving before, how easy can I give negative feedback to my professor, to my boss, no? If it's absolutely a taboo to criticize a professor, then probably the country has not a high hierarchy structure. Now, and if I can go see my professor anytime or go openly talk to my boss, then it's probably low. If you think about your own country, where do you think you would put it on this scale? Just use the whiteboard, take a little sign for a pencil, and put a little dot or a little cross where you think it is. Okay? Yeah? Mm-hmm. This totally looks like modern art masterpiece. I think we can maybe try to sell it at Sotheby's at some time. You see yourselves, no? That the majority of the group actually put their sign a little bit on the right side, no? Towards the plus. It is, of course, very difficult to measure hierarchy or to be absolutely sure. Indeed, the majority of Central Asian countries definitely have a larger power distance between, let's say, employees and bosses or students and professors. No? We also see that there are some marks, of course, on the lower end of our scale, where the hierarchy is more flat. Now, let's go back to the presentation and take a look. Take a look at the approximate distribution of countries. Now, as I said before, it's very hard in culture to measure something. Now, it's not really math. So just to give you a feeling, no? The Netherlands, for instance, no? is really indeed a country with rather flat hierarchy, with very open very open for feedback. No? This is something that that I personally found to be very different between my relationships with the professors in Russia and in the Netherlands, that asking questions that would be maybe in a little negative way criticize the professor or openly disagreeing with the professor in Russia was not really allowed, no? At the same time, in the Netherlands, that was considered to be part of critical thinking. You don't disagree with the professor for the sake of disagreement, but if you disagree and have arguments for it, it was very much appreciated, no? So that was something that I had to learn, for instance, no? We see Scandinavian countries also on the maybe bit lower end. Germany is a funny example. It is often fine maybe to disagree with a professor, but at the same time, for those of you who go to Germany, very often you will notice how important it is to mention the title. Let's say if your professor is a doctor, then you will have, you will need to say Dr. Müller. No? While in other countries, maybe it's not as important to mention the title. We see that Slovenia is also kind of in the middle. And then we have just a few cultures here that are on the higher side of this power distance picture. We do not see the Central Asian countries here. It's just a handful of countries that we use, but China, super huge hierarchy, no? Japan as well, and Russia without any doubt. So what does it mean for you when you go to a country with other hierarchy perception? Well, first of all, the very first advice is always to observe, no? You will be also observing how the local students communicate with the professors and see what is allowed and what is expected. No? However, this slide already maybe gives you a little bit of an idea into which direction, no, the perception of hierarchy would be going in your destination country, in your target country. Okay, another cultural dimension that we mentioned was perception of time, and I would also add to it tolerance of uncertainty. Tolerance of uncertainty, it sounds very complicated. Basically, it is also different how ready different people in different cultures are to take the risk. No, and I'll just give you some examples, and then you will understand. Uncertainty in life, basically, is avoided through a lot of rules and a lot of regulations and a lot of planning, no? And a lot of different structures. So, for instance, when we look at this one, this is an example of uncertainty avoidance in Germany. No? What we see is a little... I think it's a construction site or something was broken in the woods. So they put, I don't know, 5 signs warning about this so that uncertainty is avoided. Yeah? That you are certain that nobody will fall down into that, I don't know what happened there, into that hole in the ground maybe. Now we have another example of another culture, which is also Western European, where uncertainty maybe is not that much avoided. No? You don't have to have a driving license to understand that this traffic situation is absolutely not logical, because there are 3 signs all telling different things where you can drive or not drive. No? So this is something important for you also to understand, especially if you're going to countries with high uncertainty avoidance, like Germany, we had an example. No? This is why they want to have so many rules, and this is why they want to have so many plans. Because otherwise, they don't feel comfortable, because they are not certain what's going to happen. In other countries, just take it a bit easier. No? Okay, whatever happens, happens, no? Qui sera, sera. And so that's why they don't need that much of planning, no? Since we compared Germany and France in this little example, I will show you one more video. Okay. Loading. I think that a lot of times the speed of video depends on your own internet at home, so there's not much we can do to influence it, but we'll just try it one more time and then go on with the webinar, okay?
Local knowledge. HSBC, the world's local bank.
When we think about your... Mojca, you need to put Slovenia. This is what everybody is interested in. Slovenia, in the middle. No? So not, yeah, not... Not too much parallel, but also not too much step by step. Now, I would be interested actually, and this is, I think, is a more difficult question, to see what you think where your country is. Now, we'll do a similar exercise, no? Now, this would be then time, and here it would be, now I will put it like this, parallel. And here it would be step by step. This is a very abstract modern art, Kandinsky style. I'm very proud. Well, so where do you think your country is? Is it more parallel, kind of talking on the phone, sending the email while doing manicure at the same time, or things need to be done step by step? Or what do you think? So, of course, yeah, it depends. Remember the triangle we were talking about? It depends on the situation very often, or on people. There are people who are just not very multitasking. It also very much depends on the gender, nah? Because men are generally not very multitasking. I'm joking. Okay, but it gives us a little bit of a picture of what you think that... Most of your countries, and I would also say that, are more, parallel, a little bit, not take it easy, not so many plans, not so many structures. But you need to remember that especially Northern European countries, structure also regarding your study plan or your writing your essays. Now it's a lot of things are about about structure. So just keep it in mind when you will be preparing your assignments. Okay, thank you very much for drawing. What is actually interesting is that very often those countries that tend to have more of parallel time management, where we agreed that it's most of your countries as well, they also tend to this wonderful phenomenon called last minute stress. Yeah. Again, depends on the personality or situation, but very often it's in those parallel time management countries where, you know, the project needs to be already done. The project needs already to be entering its final stage. Because here we have the results. It already needs to be having the results. And it's this final last effort, this sleepless night before the deadline, before submission of the essay or thesis or work project, that gives us this final adrenaline kick in parallel time management countries, which at the same time, I must say, does not mean that the result will not be achieved. It's not about the quality of the result. It's about the way where you start and how you plan. Now, the only thing is that if you look at this graph, and imagine that, let's say, we take people from countries that tend to be more parallel, Central Asian, for example, in their time management, and they need to do a project together with the Germans. Nobody says that the project will not be done or will have bad quality. But imagine the Germans, who would be starting very early with step by step here preparing things, and you, with your part of the project, might still be thinking and kind of getting inspiration, and being here in the lower part of the results graph. So we have here this gap. This is what is shown by this error. And you think, okay, well, gap, but in the end, everything will be done. Yes, but during this gap, people here, our little German friends, for example, they will be very nervous because they will be thinking, you're not going to get your part done. And you, on your side, might be thinking, remember our circle with perception and interpretation? You might be thinking, why do they have to be so early? We still have time. I mean, what's the point? Take it easy. So this is very, very often, this time differences, time perception differences, very often lead to a little bit of tension, maybe even a little bit of conflict. So it's very difficult to give you a clear recipe, but just keep it in mind when you enter study groups with countries that tend to be more linear. Okay, communication. We already have on the very first slide here a clear difference in communication. So what type of communication is shown on this cartoon? What's the difference here? Yes, the gentleman is official, being formal, and the lady is informal, yes, official versus informal, absolutely correct. So communication, as we said before, is very broad, and so already there we see those differences. The fun thing is that, of course, when you meet people for the first time, you're not really sure. Well, even if you observe, there is this first contact that you need to take, so you don't really have an opportunity to observe, well, how are you supposed to address people? Is it more formal or more informal? So there might be some funny situations there. But what I also want to draw your attention to is the differences in communication on intercultural level very often are direct communication versus indirect. Now, what is direct communication? This is what is shown on the slide through this graph. Direct is direct. So what matters is what I say. I also can criticize openly because it only matters my constructive critique. And it's the verbal aspects, the facts, what I am saying. The indirect strategy is more how I'm saying it. What is my facial expression, the non-verbal communication aspects? What is the context? Who is next to me? Because I would probably be saying it in a different way if there was another person. And very often, people or cultures that tend to communicate more indirectly, the goal of doing that is maintaining the harmony. Or maybe you've also heard the expression losing face. In a lot of Asian countries, it's a very important cultural concept that by straightly, directly telling something, especially if it's something negative, you lose face, you lose your own face. So in order to maintain this harmony between people, the social harmony, it's better to kind of between the lines, beat around the bush a little bit. So here we have an example of direct communication and indirect communication. Now look at this cartoon. Sometimes direct communication and indirect communication are mixed with being polite and impolite. And that is actually something very difficult because it's not necessarily true. A person communicating directly, let's say, again, the Dutch, people from the Netherlands, are quite direct in what they're saying. They don't see a point of all this, excuse me, sir, I'm terribly sorry. I'm terribly sorry, la, 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 la. They just say what they need or ask for what they need. While other countries, let's think of Arab countries, not very indirect, very kind of, well, I will tell you, and you interpret what I'm saying. Let's see again. What do you think? Where your country is? Is it more direct? Draw a straight line. So direct will be here. And indirect will be here. Where do you think you are? Yeah, again, a big variety, because this one is also very difficult to even estimate or think about, because it's so dependent on the situation. Maybe you are direct when you're asking for something, but you're indirect when you criticize. The cultural difference that have noticed, 50-50, 60-40 maybe, you're right. The cultural difference that I've noticed very much is the attitude to feedback. And this is something that has to do with this direct and indirect communication. I am not an expert on Central Asian countries, but I think, you're welcome, bye. But I think that the notion of feedback, of asking your professor or even maybe your classmates for feedback is something that is not yet very much there in Central Asian cultures, no? Because very often it is associated with critique. If I'm asking for feedback, I will be criticized, no? And this is something very different in most of Western European countries. Asking for feedback is expected because this is how you improve yourself, no? And it is in the beginning also difficult on an emotional level to really get used to it and not to take it as critique, no? But to take it as constructive feedback, as constructive critique, because this makes your work or your thesis or your research makes it better, no? So this would be another advice that I would be giving you, is when you are in your classes and go on your studies, please do not take feedback personally as something negative, and do not hesitate to ask for feedback, because this would help you to improve your work. Okay, another dimension that we were mentioned that we had before, what I was explaining you, not this task and relationship, maybe a bit of a funny example. Remember I told you it's very hard to measure culture. So there was an experiment where people were timing, now with a timer, how long it takes for a small talk in business meetings. Now, this is not university, this is business, but still is interesting. Now, what is small talk? Small talk is not something just maybe that not very important, not very meaningful, you know, how's the weather? Yes. How was your travel? Just, you know, to be polite. Yeah. So this is very interesting because now let's see, who is the absolute champion of no small talk from this experiment? That was Germany. The whole small talk lasted, 3 or 4 minutes, as we see on the graph. Now, so when the meeting starts, everybody comes into the meeting room, introduces themselves. Bye. Thank you. Introduce themselves, and that's it. Then they start. Finland, not too much far away, but there is some coffee, no? Americans already do it in a bit different way, already longer, no? With a very important, a wisecrack. Wisecrack is a little joke, no? A little icebreaker. No? Very important, because this is what you use small talk for, is to make a little joke to get everyone in a good mood. Then further, no? Great Britain, classic weather talk, of course, was in all our English books. Yes, and then you're absolutely right, Parviz. Then we go to the countries that use some time for those small talk. Now look, France or Spain and Italy, now it's over 20 minutes of small talk. And there we have a funny combination of the very last one, no? Spain and Italy, where this small talk experiment also reveals the differences in time perception. No? Small talk while others arrive. No? So there we also see maybe a stereotype of punctuality. No? This little experiment is actually a very good illustration of... there we have Slovenia, very nice. A very nice illustration of this task or relationship orientation. Huh? Where do you start? In Spain and Italy, it's very important to get to know the people a little bit, to have the atmosphere, huh? To discuss whatever, you know, football and things. Huh? And then you get to business, yeah? While, let's say in Germany or here in Finland, as this experiment shows, you get the business first, and then afterwards, no, comes maybe the person. So this is again here a little graph for you, na? Task-oriented cultures. Germany, Switzerland, the Netherlands also maybe in this direction. They start with a task, no, with the facts, and through good work together, a personal relationship is established, and then you can maybe become friends. While in countries that are more maybe relationship oriented, you start with a relationship. Now you first need to get to know the people, or maybe you start with the person because you got a referral. It's a friend of a friend of a friend. No? And this is why you already trust that person even before you started working with him. And then you get to work because you have a relationship. Now, similar question. Last one for today. On this scale, where do you think your country is? If this is more relationship here on the right, no? And on the left is more task, where do you think you start, or what is more typical? Yeah, this is also what I thought, that most of Central Asian countries are actually very relationship oriented, and networks, personal contacts, not family ties or friends play a big role when working together or even studying. Well, what you need just to learn from this webinar is that there are countries that do it, so to say, differently, you know, where, so that you're not offended when nobody wants to talk about weather with you, or nobody is asking many questions in the beginning of a study group discussion, no? Because it's first you do the work, and then you get to know each other, no? In Northern European countries, that would often be the case. Okay, so we spoke about those cultural dimensions, and what I also wanted to show you maybe is a little bit of a glimpse underneath the iceberg. As I said before, we cannot talk about all the countries where you will be going to in details, no? But we can maybe see some things behind the curtains. What I would show you now is a little example that that I was having in the Netherlands, based on my experience, where I will just break down, similar to this circle exercise that I did, behavior, interpretation, and what is the value, why people were doing things like they were doing, and why it shocked me or why I didn't understand. So, first of all, those were the things that I saw in the Netherlands during my first couple of weeks when I arrived. So what I saw, rusty, horrible looking bicycles with, you know, making noises everywhere. During the class, the discussions were very, very long. And when we had to do some group assignments, everybody was just, we could never agree on it. Everybody was just saying their opinion all the time. I gave you an example of not girls pumping their own bikes. Nobody was ever helping me with a suitcase either. And of course, the very first day, the professors asked us to call them by their first name. Me, coming from Russia, I was very confused. So this is what I thought, no? This is what I thought. If the Dutch, you know, they're not the poorest nation of the world, so if they have old, horrible looking bikes, they must be very greedy, very messy, because they don't take care of their things. Long discussions in groups, well, I thought, boring people, they cannot make decisions. that Dutch have no manners. The men have no manners. I told you already. And calling professors by their first name, I thought, well, no respect, no respect towards elder people. So I was confused. After some time being there and discovering the country, discovering the part underneath the iceberg, I was able to explain a little bit why people were behaving this way by their values. No? This is something that you also, one of you mentioned as part of the culture. The value behind rusty old bikes is modesty. The Dutch don't like to show off. No? Look, I'm rich, I can afford this and that, and I have Dolce & Gabbana everywhere. They don't like that. That's not their style. No? Their style is more modesty, so that's why they don't have a problem with having an old bicycle. During the discussions in class, it is very important for people to come to a consensus. That means that everybody in the end agrees. No? So they were not indecisive. They were just trying to give everyone a chance to express their opinion, because consensus is a value in the Netherlands. Dutchmen do not have no manners. It's the egalitarianism, the equality between genders, that is a big value. So for them, it was almost rude to assume that I cannot pump my bike myself, because women are equal with men. So that's the value behind. And calling professors by their first name is, of course, not the example we saw before, informality. It's a value of communication. So if we wrap up, now those would be then the values, let's say, for the Netherlands. Now, I prepared some examples for the countries that I think some of you would be going to. So let's look at them. French. French take very long breaks very often for lunch, for coffee, and generally like food very much. So when you want to work with them, you think, what, are they lazy? Why do they take breaks? Nah. The value behind, however, is very typical French expression. In French, it's called savoir vivre. That means enjoying life, getting the best out of life. Which is a big value and a big concept in France. No? When having French students in our classes, they were always trying to find some unusual solutions or offer some fancy things for the presentation. No? So I always thought, well, they were trying to show off all the time and get the attention. No? But the value behind is that creativity and being original is very much appreciated. Again, during our group work, I noticed that for French, it was not very typical to make sacrifices for the group. Now, it was more individual always, whatever was good for themselves. So I thought egoistic people cannot work in teams. The value behind is freedom. They don't want to do something that they don't want to do, no? So it's this individuality and not collectivism. You're welcome, bye. From those two examples that we looked at, the Netherlands and France, we already notice that the values are never negative. So it's actually very, very rare that people do something because they want to do something negative to you. No? So this circle that we were discussing before is actually, although it's very typical for a human, it's wrong to think all the time that people have something against you, or they communicate to you or say something and do something to you in order to hurt your feelings. No? So this whole misinterpretation is actually not very correct, because the values behind are usually positive. No? So those would be the values for the French. Now, free expression of opinion and individualism, we talked about that. Similar exercise maybe for Italians. Very well dressed, not very stylish. and hair, men do their hair very nicely. So, you know, what is the perception? That their look is so important to them, that it's only kind of, or they're so rich. No, the value behind is an Italian expression called bella figura. No? Nice figure, no? Looking nice means respect towards yourself and the others. No? It's a big value in that country. Remember we talked about uncertainty avoidance and structures and plans. Well, Italians very often refuse to follow strictly the rules or the procedures, so the perception is that it's a bit chaotic. Well, the value behind is, again, personal freedom and eagerness to take risk. It doesn't bother them, this uncertainty. Another thing that we noticed was allocating resources to people they know. Basically, you know, this relationship orientation. At the same time, the perception would be, well, you know, you can never be part of it because it's all old school boys network and it could lead to corruption. Well, the value behind is that trust is gained, no? Through relationships. I would like to, when you go abroad to Europe, I would like you to remember those little exercises that we are doing now, not trying to split in your head what's the behavior, now what is the person actually doing, how it is interpreted in your mind, and what could be the value behind. Now, and that is also a very appropriate question to ask to the people, to the locals. Well, you know, why do you do that? What's the value behind? No? And those would be then values for Italy. No? Della figura being the first one. A lot of you also go to Slovenia, and of course Slovenia, Slovenian University is a coordinator of this project. So Mojca also helped me to prepare the slides for Slovenia. So I will be explaining them, but maybe if she could do it better, she would comment in the chat. No? When you will go there, you will see Slovenia is very nice. It's very cozy. No? People make a great effort in making their houses look nice with the flowers, and they paint them in nice colors. No? So this is a value. Another one is stability and family ties. Different countries do it differently, but for Slovenians, it's more typical to stay in the same house, no? Not to move around a lot. Very different from Americans, for example, who move a lot around their own country. No? Building their own house with the community helping them. No? This is something important for Slovenians. At the same time, discipline and hardworking and honesty are, of course, values. Now, those who go there, please notice that the Slovenians themselves told me not to call them Balkan countries or East Europeans. They like to be called Alpine Nation, a country in the Alps. So what do they like? Wine and beer. You're welcome. Bye-bye. And of course, if they like wine and beer, they must like music. And most of them are good singers. You will be surprised to know how well they do in different sports and how much they like nature. Now, this is also something very, very typical. The negative part is that they drive like crazy and sometimes very aggressive. So be careful. Although I must say, I don't think that it's much different from driving in Central Asian countries. Although in Almaty, it's already much better the last time I visited. Okay. We will just go through some values that I put together. As I said in the very beginning, this webinar will be available, the recording will be available, and the presentation will be available, so you will be able to use it or share it with your friends or maybe even families. So those would be some Spanish values. And I think we have someone from Spain among participants, so if those are wrong, please comment. Okay. So far it's correct. We've spoken a lot about Germany because I think a lot of you are going to Germany. Those are the values that I put together for that country. But we also gave a lot of examples for it already. I think there were a couple of people going to Sweden. So for Scandinavian countries, that consensus is also very important. Expression of opinion and finding a common solution for everybody might take a lot of time during the study groups and joint presentations. Modesty is something also important for them, just like for the Dutch. They also love nature very much. I don't know if someone is going to Austria. I think that person left already. Another thing that I would like to briefly mention, you might have heard of it already before, culture shock. Anyone heard of that? Yes. It's a famous idiom almost. Yeah. So, if we put it in a graph, this is what culture shock might look like. No, remember, personality, context, you never know for sure how it works for everyone, but it might work like this. No? So that in the beginning, it's all normal, so you're kind of experiencing, okay, what's where do I buy milk, and where do I buy a ticket for train, and what's the name of my professor, so it kind of goes up and down, no? And then once you got through those first things, you know where to get stuff, you know how to get to the university, you already have some friends, it goes up. Now your feelings go up. This is called honeymoon. You start enjoying it very much, you have a lot of fun, and you want to travel all the time and explore. Now, after that, there might be a bit of stress stage. When those new things are not new anymore, so they're not very exciting, but maybe annoying. Maybe the new things, the things that they do differently in your destination country, maybe they start to annoy you. Maybe you start missing home, missing food, missing family a little bit. So that might be here a bit of stress, which then afterwards goes a little bit up, it improves and becomes a stable stage. So in the maybe last quarter of your stay, it's all stable and you're satisfied. Before you leave, very typical is that you start getting so excited about your stay there. You want to buy all the souvenirs you can, and maybe the very last time go to that one bar and travel to that one more village that you liked so much. So you want to get the rest of the positive feelings. And very often after you return, especially in the very beginning, maybe not in the first 2 days when you're excited to see your family and friends, but a bit later, it's re-entry shock. Where you notice that, well, I've experienced so much and I've seen so many new things when I was abroad, and my friends and family back home, it seems like nothing has changed and things are still the same, and the same old little grandmas sitting outside on the streets and talking. So it's difficult a little bit to find yourself back. This might be how you will have it. You might have it in a different way, but it's important to recognize the stress phase of culture shock. When you have a honeymoon phase, you're just happy, so that's fine. But when you start get sad or lonely, or sometimes you can't even sleep very well, and you're not sure you can do well in school, and kind of a little bit depressed. Now it's important to recognize that in yourself, and recognizing that it's not you going crazy, but it's culture shock. It's normal. So the next question, okay, But what do we do? If you notice that you don't feel very comfortable at some point, you know, take it easy on yourself. It's very good, you know, to do some sports, have some exercises, but also to learn more, especially about your host country, because the more you know, the less uncertain you are in behavior of the people or, you know, how the systems work. Learning the language or speaking to local people gives you more information. Just maybe, you know, be easy on yourself. Studying as such is already difficult. And studying in a foreign country, in a foreign language, is a lot of stress for your brain and for your body. So at some point, you need to take it easy if you notice that it's a bit of shock times. There are actually advantages of culture shock on the positive side about learning about yourself. Now, this is psychological development and personality development that you will be going through. Okay. The last topic I wanted to mention is, I don't know if you realize it, but when you go abroad, you will be an ambassador of your own country. And I must tell you that the countries where you come from are quite special and exotic. The chances that a lot of local people traveled to your countries are very low. No? So that's why they might not know a lot of things about your countries, and you as ambassador under the Erasmus Mundus project are the ones who can also a little bit educate your study classmates or new neighbors, telling them maybe about your country. Well, I want you to think, what are the ways to present your country, or how would you try to maybe educate others about your country? What do you think? Yes, food is excellent. Excellent idea, because this is something pleasant. Now everybody likes to eat, and it could be combined with a nice explanation of, you know, where this food comes from and why it's cooked this way and how you eat it. What's the tradition behind? So all types of little food parties is always a good idea. Presentations, that would be also maybe an excellent idea to go with the food. Now, if you do a little presentation and with some pictures, now with some photos, and showing videos again. Yeah, bringing pictures is a good idea. Small talk, like the Spanish do, yes. Yes, basically anything that you mentioned there are all very good ideas, and I hope you're not shy to also do them. Very often international students also get together and actually organize those type of international parties where maybe national food is cooked and there is a little local Eurovision contest where everybody can sing their song, and or World Vision contest. So that would be a really a good idea, yeah. I'm actually done with the presentation, with the knowledge that I wanted to share with you on intercultural communication. We have 10 minutes time left, approximately 10:15. So you have a choice now. We can either have a little quiz with some funny questions about Europe just to see how much you know, or we can leave that time for you to ask any questions you want in the chat, and I will see if I can reply to them, or if Moitza maybe can reply to them. So what do you say? I'll do a little What do we do? Questions? Quiz. Okay, you know what? Let's just do both. If you just want to stay a little bit longer to ask your questions, we can also do that. That's not a problem. Okay, well then, let's do, I prepared 20 questions of a quiz. We'll do 10, and then we'll have some time for the questions that you might have for me or for Mojca. All right? Okay, first question. Uh-huh. Okay, so this is what you said, and I think that most of you were correct. I had to update the quiz because Croatia joined the European Union recently, so there used to be 27, now there's 28. Very good. Next one. That's a tricky question with the languages. Now there are 28 countries, so what languages are official, what are not official? That's difficult. Okay, so this was what you thought, and now we will look at the correct answer. And we do not see Russian in that list, so those who chose Russian were correct, but Maltese is in the official language. So let's go on and do the next question. Difficult to say, right? Okay, so those were your thoughts. Most thought London, but some also thought Rome and Berlin, right? And the correct answer is London. Much bigger than anything else. And this is also an interesting thing now about perception that sometimes you think that other cities are also as big, but not really. Okay, next question. Unusual question, because if you thought all my questions will be formal, you were wrong. Here we go. Stereotypes. Okay, so most of you thought Germany, right? And let's look at the correct answer. Stereotypes. See, Germans do drink a lot of beer, but Czechs drink even more. Okay. Now. So, most of you think Norway, Finland, okay, now this is what you thought. So most of you thought Norway, a bit of for Finland, a bit for Sweden, and the correct answer is, most of you were correct. It is confusing about Norway because it is not in the EU, but it is in Schengen, which means you don't need a visa to Norway if you have a European visa, and it's part of the internal market. Very confusing. Finland is a member of the European Union. Okay, unusual question. Be ready? Okay, I think most of you do know something about food because fish and chips is a traditional British meal. Fish is fish and chips are French fries, chardonnay kartoshka. So we do four more questions. Maybe I should pick the difficult one. Now, let's stay by food. It's almost 50-50. But the correct answer is, it's very confusing, but French fries is the most favorite Belgian snack. This is what they sell very often in kiosks, and you can order it to pretty much every meal. Might be unhealthy, so be careful if you go traveling there. Okay. Next question. Oh, so nobody thought a lot of people go to Bulgaria. Well, that's unusual, but so it's basically UK, and some of you thought Germany. Okay. The UK. A lot of international students, and I think that the main reason is that English is spoken. So it's number two after the US in the world, na? With a lot of international students. Okay, two more questions. Yeah, this is a very difficult question, and I hope you're not Googling while thinking. Okay, now let's see. Basically, I think you had no idea because you chose all the options. and the correct answer. Now, be prepared that there are no children around because the correct answer is very scary. This is indeed a pre-Christmas tradition where a bad guy, which looks so horrible, walks around the Austrian streets scaring the kids so that they're not bad and they get their presents. So if you're ever there in Austria around that time, don't get scared. Okay. Last one. Okay, again, a variety of opinions, which means that you have no idea. France is the largest, no? And Sweden is actually also very big, that we often forget. Okay, well, that was fun to see that you already know a lot about Europe. And I'm sure you will find out much more. Now let's do a questions and answers session. And I suggest that I give you 2 or 3 minutes time to type your questions. And be sure to ask, is the question for me or for Moitsa? And then we will be looking at the questions and then we will answer them. So you have 2 or 3 minutes to type them, okay? Thanks for this information. So be sure to you check out the website and join the Facebook fan page where you can be in touch. And thank you very much for your attention. I hope that technically it worked for most parts. The recording of this webinar will be available, so I will provide Moitza with the link to the presentation and the webinar that you can also share it or look at it at some later point. So she will have this information. Thank you. Okay, there's one question for Moitza. So she'll answer that.
I'm back.
Yeah, so Moitza can also maybe answer
okay,
some questions.
Okay, so during the studies,
give some information.
You need to stay at the university, but
have,
there will be some holidays available.
No other
for sure,
questions for us? Then
you
can continue
and
actually talking in the chat. We do not have to finish it. Parviz asks a question about traveling in Europe. And also maybe from my side, Parviz, the good news is that flying around Europe is much cheaper than flying in Central Asia. There is a lot of low-cost airlines, so that during vacations you can really, if you plan in advance, you can find some cheap tickets and explore some countries around. Yes, if you have a Schengen visa, you can travel to other European countries that are in Schengen zone. I'm tipping the airlines.
Regarding the question to meet other Erasmus Mundus students from this consortium, the best way is that you go to the Facebook, the page that we created, and we will also send to all grantees the invitation to join the group. And there, it's the easiest way to meet with others and to chat and to see what plans they have during the holidays. Because we are not actually allowed to give you emails without the previous approval of the person. That's why the Facebook is quite easy to use. Okay. For any questions, you are more than welcome to write to the email. I will just type it again. Mandala Kersplosion. In our office, we are me and Claudia, so there's always one of us here, so we will respond as soon as possible. How to find the roommates and apartment? It depends where you go, so the local coordinator should already provide you with information. And usually what universities in Europe do, they make a Facebook page where students already meet before they actually arrive to a country, so they can find roommates already before. But what usually people do, they book a hostel for 2 days or 3 days, and then in those 2 days for sure you find roommates. Maybe one other thing, for sure you were already informed about the orientation program each partner organizes, and you should make sure to attend the orientation program, because there you get all the essential information regarding study as well as living in that city. No, Saikal. Okay, in Ljubljana, the orientation program will be in the week of 23rd September. Yes, because we counted those days in, so for sure you will be here and get all the information. Are there any other questions? Ce-am greșit la Paris? Albia. 21st. Claudia will answer this question. Tipkar tipke. Elmira, we have a good connection with the embassy in Moscow, so everything is going very smoothly so far. So, no problems so far. Yeah. Okay, before we call back Natalia, I just wanted to say a big thank you to participate in our first webinar. It was very informative for me as well, and I really hope that it will help you before you go to Europe, and also please watch it during your stay and maybe after you return home and share it with as much people as possible, because we want to prevent, of course, cultural shock as much as possible. So please, Natalia, your final words.
Thank you very much. It was, of course, we were all a little bit nervous organizing this webinar for the first time. But I think besides some little minor technical things, it went well, and I hope you enjoyed it. And answering your question if there will be any other webinars, at this point, we have not planned anything. This was the pilot thing, the experiment for us to do, so we will see.
Are there any suggestions for a webinar?
I think if you have some ideas, maybe you will be able to communicate them maybe already when you are in Europe, and then we can be very quick in organization. Mm-hmm. So thank you all for taking part. Then we just say goodbye and thank you very much for your attention. And Mojca will have the links to the recording of the webinar and to the presentation. So
okay. Thank you, Natalia.
Thanks a lot, and have a good stay in Europe.
Okay. Thank you, Natalia, very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.
This is not the deal.